de blocuri, râmpe în soare argintii, zeci de blocuri, în zor de zi.
I have one concern about these vlogs. I'm terrible at doing two things at the same time. Whenever I worked on a big project in the past, I've always ended up on the same route. First, I put whatever I was working on hold to focus on the new project. Second, I get really stressed because I realize it takes a lot more time and effort to finish it than I thought. Third, I crack and I decide to release some quick content in an effort to feel relevant again and not lose my audience. And finally, I realize that quick content isn't actually quick at all because it also requires a lot of time and effort. So I end up focusing on the quick content because I started while the big project is on hold, while the regular videos are on hold, and then I just wanna cry. Now, I'm determined to do things differently this time. I've got to remember, the book is my main priority, then the energy video, and the vlog is to be done in my spare time. But already I feel all my creativity and focus is flowing into this vlog. We'll see how it goes.
Pe albastrele cărări Macarale suie în zel.
Anyway, in this video I'd like to bring you up to speed with what I've been doing fitness-wise. The main news is that for the last 5 months, I've trained with a full body routine 4 times a week. Yes, I've jumped on the bandwagon last summer. So I thought I'd give you my thoughts on high frequency training, since I'm sure you've seen the trend and you might have been interested in trying it out. In short, I like it a lot. I think it's my favorite training style ever, if I ignore an injury, which I'll talk about later. The main idea of my full body routine is very simple. I've kept the same amount of volume I've been doing on my Shred Smart bulking routine, but I rearranged it throughout the week so that I do only 1 or 2 exercises for each muscle group every workout. Now, I'm sure the first question you'll ask me is why? Is this better than bro splits? Is this better than upper lower splits, push-pull legs? Should I be doing this too? My short answer is, on paper, it should be better, but in the real world, it's probably more or less equal to programs where each muscle group is trained around 2x per week. As you may remember, my fitness philosophy falls mostly into the nihilistic camp. I don't actually think there are large differences between training programs as long as there's progressive tension overload. That is, you're getting stronger in a medium rep range. Guys have gotten big with all sorts of volumes and frequencies, but one thing is always the same. Big natural guys are also strong as hell. If you're currently getting stronger on the program you're doing, it's unlikely that a higher training frequency would get you better results. But if you're not progressing, despite not missing workouts and tracking your lifts, then I think it's worth trying different training styles. That is my nihilistic view. But look, what do I know? Let me now give you the long answer and see what the research says. Several recent meta-analyses have analyzed the effect of training frequency on muscle growth and strength, and they've all shown a small advantage to training a muscle group more than once a week when volume is matched. In other words, if you do the same number of sets in a week, bro splits are the least effective choice. However, when volume is matched and muscle groups are trained at least 2x per week, it's no longer clear whether a higher frequency is better. It seems to be pretty equal, although the trend usually favors the higher frequency. Put in simple terms, beyond the frequency of 2x per week, you might not get any additional benefits in terms of muscle growth and strength, assuming you do the same number of sets per week. But the interesting thing is that on paper, full body programs should be the better choice, especially for advanced lifters. Remember that the main drivers of progress are weekly volume and intensity. Beginners can make maximum progress with just 10 sets per body part per week. Intermediates do well on around 15 sets per week, and advanced lifters might need 15 to 20 plus sets per week. This volume is effective when each of those sets is taken to within 1 and 3 reps to failure, or 7 to 9.5 RPE, while the rep range can vary. Generally, around 70% of the sets should be done in the 5 to 8 rep range and 30% in the 1 to 4 and 10 to 15 ranges. When you look at it this way, you can see that low frequencies pose a problem. As an intermediate or advanced lifter, with a bro split you have to fit 15 to 20 hard sets in a single workout. Obviously, the last few exercises are going to suffer due to fatigue. So it makes sense to split that volume in two workouts of 8 to 10 sets each. This is much more manageable and the main idea behind upper-lower or push-pull-leg splits. But perhaps you could distribute the weekly volume over even more workouts, so that you can perform just one or two exercises per muscle group in a fresher state. For instance, say you do three exercises for chest one after the other: bench press, incline dumbbell press, and hammer machine press. You might use 100 kg on bench, 40 kg dumbbells, and 80 kg on the hammer press. Naturally, if you did incline dumbbell press and hammer machine press on different days instead, you could use more weight or perform more reps because you wouldn't be fatigued from the previous exercises. And since progressive tension overload is the main driver of gains, you should be making better progress. Now, of course, an objection to this might be,
"This is such bullshit. One exercise. You don't even get to stress the muscle fibers properly."
That's actually a valid point. While high muscular tension is the initiating factor for protein synthesis, a certain number of contractions, aka reps, are needed to turn it on. We don't know exactly how many. For instance, Mattox and colleagues found that a group that did two workouts a week, each consisting of five sets of one single max rep, didn't gain any muscle over the course of 8 weeks. So five heavy singles on the bench press machine per workout does not seem to be enough to turn on muscle growth. However, if there is such a thing as a lower threshold of volume you need to perform for a workout to become effective, it seems to be very low. A recent study by Colquhoun and colleagues showed that it's probably less than 2 sets per muscle group. They took 2 groups of intermediate lifters and had them do the same number of weekly sets for the same number of reps, but with different volume per workout. One group did 3 workouts per week, consisting of 4 sets per exercise, while the other group did 6 workouts per week, consisting of just 2 sets per exercise. At the end of the study, both groups gained almost exactly the same amount of strength and muscle. So just 2 sets of 3 on the deadlift, 2 sets of 5 on the squat, and 2 sets of 8 on the bench press per workout was enough to stimulate muscle growth and strength gains. In fact, the higher frequency group slightly outperformed the lower frequency group in all measured categories except squats. In a full body program, you'd be doing 3 to 6 sets per muscle group per workout, and therefore that should be enough to stimulate gains. And actually, if anything, it should be better than doing a lot of volume per session. A recent study by Barbello and colleagues had 4 groups of intermediate lifters do either 5, 10, 15, or 20 sets to failure per muscle group in a single workout once a week. At the end of the study, they found that the guys doing 5 and 10 sets per workout gained more muscle and strength than the guys doing 15 and 20 sets. Their findings suggest that there seems to be an upper threshold of effective volume per workout, around 5 to 10 sets performed close to failure, above which additional sets don't stimulate further gains. Basically, if you train heavy, the first few sets are the most important. They give you most of the gains. Which explains why low volume, high intensity training styles, like reverse priming training, work. This can also be observed in one of the most influential studies on muscle growth of all time, by Wernbaum and colleagues. They found that 30 to 60 reps per muscle group per workout appear to yield the largest gains, but 20 reps per workout produced almost the same results. Sure, the guys doing more gained more, but nowhere near twice or 3 times as much. My takeaway from these points of evidence is that there are definitely diminishing returns to volume performed per workout. The first few sets seem to be the most effective at stimulating muscle and strength gains, and as you progressively add more, they stimulate gains less and less. So once again, it would make sense to distribute that volume among multiple workouts because it would make it more effective. Now remember, this is still mostly theory. The best proof we have that this is true in practice as well is the controversial Norwegian Frequency Project. In this study, the Norwegian elite powerlifting team was put on the exact same weekly volume and intensity, with the exception that one group did 3 workouts a week, while the other group did 6 workouts per week. This means that the 3 times per week group needed to do twice as many sets per session compared to the 6 times per week group. And after 15 weeks, the high frequency group increased their squat 11% compared to 5%, bench press 11% compared to 6%, deadlift 9% compared to 6%, and they also gained more muscle. These are staggering results. What's even left to debate? High frequency wins, hands down. However, the full paper of this study was never published for us to be able to see how exactly the lifters were training. One reasonable criticism of the study is that it seems the low frequency group was put on the same intensity as the high frequency group, and that wasn't optimal for them. When you train a lift every day, you have to stay away from failure, so the high frequency group was lifting at around 75% of their 1RM. But when you train less frequently, it's optimal to go heavier, perhaps 85 to 90% of 1RM. The low frequency group may not have been able to train as heavy as they needed in order to keep everything the same, and as a result, some of them made no progress or actually lost muscle. If this is indeed true, and the low frequency group would have been allowed to go heavier, perhaps the difference wouldn't have been so large. On the other hand, if the high frequency group would have been forced to train at 85 to 90% of 1RM, they could have burned out or overtrained. In the end, we just don't know. We're gonna have to wait for the full paper to be published. So at the moment, it isn't settled whether a full body program is better than an upper-lower program, for instance. However, it seems to be at least equal, so it's worth trying out. Worst case scenario, your results would be more or less the same. But if you're one of the lucky guys whose body responds well to high frequency training, then you might be on your way to the gainosphere. Get it? Because the gravity is lower there and you can lift more weight? But if it's not yet clear whether full body programs are actually better for muscle and strength gains, why did I try it? Well, if I'm totally honest, I did it to avoid leg day. Yes, at heart I'm a bro, I hate leg day. This makes no sense. Now you're doing legs every time. Let me blow your mind. Doing 1 or 2 leg exercises every workout is actually way easier than doing 5 or 6 in a single session. Because you don't get as fatigued and you no longer get sore. Shut up and take my money.
Will you marry me?
Aren't you glad you hanged around? You don't hear this level of insight from research? In my case, other than leg training being easier, I haven't noticed any difference. I didn't build more muscle and I didn't gain strength faster. The workouts are just more fun because you can do each lift in a fresh state. And I guess another bonus is that all your muscle groups are pumped all the time. Because of this, even if you're not actually more muscular, you appear to be bigger compared to when you're doing body part splits. Since at this time I'm not sure whether this program is superior to a conventional body part split, I haven't added it to ShredSmart. But if you'd like to give this style of training a try, this is the routine I've been using. And these are the rep ranges and the progression model I used. If you're more advanced than me, perhaps Jeff Nippard's full body program would be better for you. Unlike mine, it's higher volume with 5 days per week, block periodization, and variable reps and load every week. For the vast majority of my audience, I suspect it's too complicated, but if you're an advanced lifter, you should find it useful. I've added an affiliate link for it in the description. I just can't do short videos. Just can't. This was supposed to be a vlog. And I wish I could end the video here, but there is one concern about this training style that I need to warn you about. You know how I said I switched to this program to be able to train legs every workout? Yeah, ironically, that's exactly what I couldn't do. I made the mistake of going from training legs once a week straight into doing squats 4 times per week. Bulgarian split squats on Monday and Thursday, and back squats on Tuesday and Friday. Everything was fine for about 2 months, and I made excellent progress. But then one day, I went to sit on the couch and I felt like I was stabbed in the knee. I developed what I think was quad tendinitis. Apparently, this can happen if you suddenly expose your tendons to a lot more stress than they're used to. I talked to my buddy Mario Tomic about this, and he told me he developed knee pain as well when attempting a squat everyday challenge for 60 days. Lyle McDonald expressed the same concern about this new trend of high-frequency training. It could be bad for connective tissue, and some people might develop tendinitis because of it. I've personally kept the weekly training volume the same, and I still got the injury. This makes me think that the sudden change in frequency was the problem. And sure, it was a stupid decision on my side, because I only did squats for legs. Maybe if I also did deadlifts and leg press and some isolation exercises, I wouldn't have had any issues. But still, if you're currently on a bro split, I wouldn't feel comfortable recommending you to jump straight into a more than 3-day-a-week full body program, because you could get joint pain. Perhaps it would be a better idea for you to gradually increase the frequency until you can handle a 4 or 5 times a week full body program. Well, there you go. My first fitness video in over 2.5 years. Do I still have it? Let me know in the comments. If you'd like to get lean in 2020, I recommend enrolling in my Shred Smart program. Now on the third version, it includes a complete plan for getting six-pack abs and muscle development without changing your lifestyle too much. Check out the link in the description. If you'd like to give full body workouts a try, check out Jeff Nippert's full body program. Jeff is one of the few people in the industry with integrity, and I can vouch for the quality of his work. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the next quote-unquote vlog.